Hello and welcome to a very special interview on Bar and Bench with a very special lady. She's been recently designated a senior counsel at the Supreme Court and also holds the office of the Additional Solicitor General of India, one of only three women to have held this post in our constitutional history. Madhavi Divan, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Was it always going to be a career in law for you?
No, most definitely not. I'm actually not quite sure why I chose the law, because I just knew very little about it. I come from a family of very diverse interests, but law was certainly not one of them. And therefore, I'm not quite sure why I was very sure that I wanted to study law. I'm not sure I wanted to practice law. But frankly, it was a shot in the dark, because I had I'd never known anything about law practice. I hadn't entered a courtroom before I actually got a law degree. I hadn't done any moots. I hadn't interned as a student. So I wasn't quite sure of what law practice entailed, but I was fortunate enough to have gotten into Cambridge to do the law tripos, and I wasn't going to let that opportunity go. But frankly, had I, you know, had I to undertake a five-year law course in one of the national law schools, I don't think I would have made it through in terms of, you know, 5 years would have been much too much for me.
So if not the law, what would it have been?
Well, it might have been something in education. I can quite see that. And I did a short stint as a teacher at Modern School, which is my own school, shortly before I went to Cambridge, and I really enjoyed that.
Let's talk a little bit about your stint in Mumbai at respected senior counsel Janak Dwarka Das's office. You worked there for quite some time.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about your experience there, and also about some really important takeaways that you came back with, which have stood you in good stead?
Yeah. So I think I was just very fortunate to have gotten into Janak's chamber, and I still consider myself his junior. It was actually through the recommendation of a family friend, a very dear family friend. Justice Kanya was known to my family, and in fact, he I had actually gone to Bombay to spend a little time in his chamber, and he thought I was going to get very bored there, so he called up Janak without even mentioning that to me, and he said that, you know, there's a family friend's daughter and I'd like her to join your chamber. And when he said that to me, I said that no, I don't want to go to the Bombay High Court, I'm quite okay where I am. And he said, well, I've already spoken to him, so you must, you know, do him the courtesy of calling him up and letting him know that you won't be coming. Of course, I'd never heard of Janak before. He wasn't even a designated senior counsel back then, but he was in very, very busy commercial practice. So I actually called Janak to tell him that, you know, thank you, but I don't think I will be coming. But I think he was so busy that he just said, you know, meet me at such and such time and on the original side of the Bombay High Court in the High Court library. And so, you know, and he just hung up. So I just had to land up there. To begin with, it was very difficult to even, you know, find the time to communicate with him, because he was just, you know, rushing from court to court. So it was difficult to keep pace with him. And we didn't have, I think his chamber was under renovation at the time, so there was no particular place to go back to in the evening. But, you know, it took a few months to really start communicating with him. But he was really excellent. He wasn't a slave driver ever. He always said that, you know, I'm not a schoolmaster, so you can come and go when you like. But the great thing was, I think the learning one took away from conferences, and one probably didn't even realize how much one was taking away, because subconsciously, perhaps, you know, how to handle a problem, it was sort of sinking in somewhere, but perhaps it took many years to even realize that. The other thing I think I really took away from Janak was drafting. He would recommend every junior to a solicitor, at least give them one opportunity, and then, you know, you know, you just had to take it from there. So I was very fortunate that he did recommend me initially. And, you know, as it turned out, I was a reasonably decent, if I can say that, you know, my drafting was reasonably good, and therefore he, you know, that kind of work grew. And that was very challenging because these were original pleadings, so there was a lot of strategizing involved. And I think I worked very well with him on that. When he settled a draft, it was really challenging. It was fun to see where your thinking and your drafting and your strategizing had how he handled that. So I think that was you know, very challenging. The other thing was, I think, written submissions, which you know, the rigor of written submissions is something I learned in that chamber. Even the art of making a really effective good list of dates, which can, I think, make or break a case. I think we give it too little credit, but even something as simple as that, I think I learned to do well.
So how did the shift to Delhi happen?
I came kicking and screaming, actually. It was a family decision, because my husband was already was designated a senior advocate in 2005, and I think he was very keen on moving to the Supreme Court. You know, I had just reached that phase in my career. You know, it was a difficult balance because I already had two very young children, and I was finally finding my feet. I think the balance between, you know, work and getting recognition for that work was gradually beginning to, you know, the right balance. And then it was time to pack up and leave. And it was a daunting thought, but it was a family decision, I think. I was very familiar with Delhi because I'd grown up here. I went to school here, I went to college here, and I had my family here. But professionally, it was very hard.
So I'd like to ask you about your early days at the bar as a woman. What were the challenges that women advocates faced early on in their careers?
Yeah, I think that I was just saying to someone yesterday that in the almost 25 years that I've spent at the bar, I think in the first at least 20 years of those 25 years, my gender was perhaps my biggest liability. That has dramatically changed now, because gender is what arouses interest now. You know, it's no longer looked upon as a liability at all. So I think early on, there were different kinds of challenges. I remember at the Bombay bar, we would sit around, very young counsel, still, you know, looking for work. We were told that you had to be in the High Court library at a particular time in the afternoon, because when the matters came in, the clerks from the law firms would come around offering small briefs for circulation or, you know, some small application at that particular time in the afternoon. So, you know, young counsel would typically be seated around this large table. And I remember that if there were even, you know, 7 or 8 or 9 of us seated around that table, and usually all of them but me were men, and it didn't matter in what sequence we were seated, the clerk would come around first to each of the men, and if each of them said no, if all of them said no, I would be the counsel of last choice. So I think that was a given. And
that interrupt, but do you think that happened uniformly with women across the board at the bar in that time?
Pretty much. And frankly, I mean, even look at it now. I was in the Bombay High Court a few months ago, and I was addressing a gathering of women lawyers. And one of the things that struck me was that the list of persons who have applied for designation, there are about, I think, 60 people who are on that list, and there are only 2 women. So I think it shows a phenomenal lack of self-belief, perhaps, and it also tells you the state of affairs. And frankly, even in those days, I couldn't think of a single role model in terms of, you know, my role models were men. I couldn't think of any women who were, you know, role models, and particularly women with families. There was just nobody as counsel. So that was one thing. And then, of course, you know, that was, of course, what I told you about sitting around the table and waiting for work was that was before I became a parent. So, you know, 3 years down the line, I was a mother. And I remember I came back within 3 months of my child being born. And I thought that was very efficient turnaround time. But obviously not, because when I came back, of course, it wasn't a job. So there was no work waiting for me at all. And of course, you know, no work meant no pay either. And the briefs that I had held that far, they were, you know, I didn't have a lot of volume, but I certainly had very good quality work. So most of that work had already been redistributed naturally to other counsel. And new work, a new brief took as much as 5 months to land up. And I was there every single day, pretty much a full day. But, you know, work took that long to come, because and I don't blame solicitors for it now, looking back. I mean, I felt bad for myself back then, but frankly, I mean, look at it from the solicitor's point a point of view, because he's got to have, or she's got to have, a counsel who he or she thinks will be able to do full justice to the brief. And when you've got so many people to think of, why would you choose a woman who you think is, you know, beset with all sorts of domestic responsibilities? So, I mean, I don't blame them anymore for not choosing me over the others. But, you know, 5 months is how long it took.
Does it sometimes happen that you represent the government in cases which are clearly lacking in merit? And in doing so, does this frustrate you? And also, do you have all the freedom in the world to go and tell them, this case does not have any merit in it, we should not be pursuing it?
Well, I often do advise, and oftentimes my advice is accepted. So we are consulted before cases are filed. That's one. And two, I think, you know, there are cases which sometimes I feel have no merit. I mean, this is true even of private cases, where I felt that a case has absolutely no merit. And then I find that the bench does want to entertain it because they have seen something that I might have missed. And therefore, you know, cases that sometimes look meritless, get noticed. And then there are cases where you think there is merit, but they get dismissed. So, you know, and the other thing with government work is that a case which, you know, in the individual's case, it may, you know, the larger repercussions may not be obvious, but sometimes there are, you know, cascading consequences for the government. There may be huge financial implications. And so cases which look otherwise, you know, perhaps meritless or very small, sometimes petty, but they are not actually so. And so, you know, we have to take all cases very seriously.
Does the clamor for extrajudicial punishment, not just from the masses, but coming also from responsible people like lawmakers, alarm you? Does it reflect on our judiciary in any way?
Yes, it does reflect on the rule of law. I think what is happening is that the whole thing has been extremely disturbing and depressing at many levels.
Could you tell us a little bit about how judges would perceive you in your early years of practice as a young woman going up for a high court judge? How would you feel, and what do you think judges perceived you like?
Well, it was a mixed bag, actually. I think there were some very good experiences, and there were some very bad ones too. And sometimes when you came across as confident, it could go against you. So it's very difficult to say where gender came in. or whether it did at all.
So the demure woman would be more appreciated?
I don't know. It's very hard to say. I think that's a question you need to ask on the other side. I don't know. But I think in more recent years, it's interesting because I've often checked myself. I think it's important not to be needlessly aggressive. I think sometimes women tend to make that mistake because we imagine sometimes that we are not going to be taken seriously enough. That is a natural tendency, and at least it's something that I have tried to check. So, you know, I think that if you're well prepared, and of course, the last appearance always makes a difference, because if you've done reasonably well in your last argument, it naturally, I mean, and obviously, it
carries through.
It at least, you know, you get that kind of reception where, you know, you will get taken seriously. So I think by and large, if you're well prepared, you are reasonably articulate, and you answer the question. You don't beat about the bush, and you don't get aggressive or difficult, and you don't interrupt. I think that's important too, frankly. I mean, that's, I think, really important. Oftentimes at the bar, we find that we're interrupting one another, we're talking over one another, and that should not happen.
Do you think that can be partially, that load can be partially shared by not bringing frivolous appeals through the system? I have an example which I could give you, for instance. There was a central administrative tribunal decision in my state in Telangana. This is pertaining to the appointment of Director General of Police. The CAT ruled in favor of the Director General of Police. The government decided that they would go to the High Court. The High Court passed strictures and said this is frivolous and fine them a token amount of money. They still decided to take this to the Supreme Court. Do you think avoiding such things, avoiding such needless litigation, would bring the load down a little bit on our court system?
Yeah, I think that process has begun. I think there is a lot of trimming that does take place at levels which, you know, you may not be aware of. It's happened with tax cases. We see it happen at many levels. And of course, there is scope for more. There is scope for more trimming. And sometimes, you know, at a certain level, an officer may feel that, you know, he will be held accountable if he lets the case go. So, you know, but yes, of course, there is scope for reducing some litigation.
Coming from someone who a lot of young women lawyers look up to and admire, what would your advice be to them when they step out of law school, cross that barrier, and get into the real nitty-gritty of the law?
Well, I think, frankly, any counsel should aspire, speaking for myself, that if one wants to be a role model, then one should be for both men and women, and not for women alone. For women, of course, the challenges are getting... Well, it's a more competitive world, and it is always harder for women, but it's getting better and better. And therefore, I think my general sense is that they've just got to be more tenacious. They've got to hang on a lot longer. Unfortunately, what we don't have in our system and what they don't teach you in law school, and, you know, I had absolutely no inkling of how my gender would impact my growth as a young lawyer. And I think women do need that kind of mentoring and guidance at that very crucial stage of their career. And not just that, because, you know, ideally one shouldn't have to give up family for a career or a career for family. So that, you know, the challenges of juggling is something I think as women we need to talk about a little more. And we need to address a little more so that it can be done. I mean, it is possible. The problem is that a lot of women just opt out and they fall off the ladder just as they are beginning to blossom as lawyers. So I think that is where women need that little bit of guidance and a little bit of encouragement and pushing. And the systems have also got to, you know, sensitize themselves. I believe there are initiatives in law firms to keep women, crèches and so on and so forth. But particularly in the rough and tumble of litigation, we don't really have enough mentoring that takes place. And as I said, even at the Bombay Bar, I did not have any mentors in terms of, you know, women who had been there, done that, raised families and had a reasonably successful practice. That just didn't exist. So, of course, there was Zia, but then Zia, you know, she set up this a law firm. So she went out of counsel practice in that sense. So, I think tenacity is the one asset a woman should have before everything else. And then, of course, I think we should stop feeling sorry for ourselves because we are women. And I think it's really important to do your work and to deliver. That is the most important test. Your merit must speak for itself. And I think, in the next 10 or 12 years, you're going to see a lot of women out there. You're just going to see a lot of women there, whether on the bench or, doing well as counsels. You've seen the last crop of their 6 senior counsels. Of course, you know, designation is one thing, but, you know, the challenge is going to be for all of us to really meet the test of whether, you know, women are going to be choices, first choices, for a briefing advocates. That's going to be the test, and for that we've just got to have to deliver.
On that really positive note, Madhavi Divan, thank you for speaking with us. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you very much.